My heart is filled with so much joy this morning. I received a lot of feedback from our sermon last week, and so many people are motivated to arise and build here in our nation. And I want to challenge everybody, for those of you who did not catch last week's sermon, I hope that you go back, you listen to it, because it really captures the heart of where we believe the Lord is taking us. There is hope in South Africa because you live here, and we are called to arise and build as a church of Jesus. Last week we looked at the prophet Joel and how to start building in this nation. We need to come to a place of deep personal repentance. It is a deep consecration to God and His will, and to see that coming to pass. But this morning we want to look at the heart of a kingdom builder. What paradigms do we need to change in our own minds if we are going to be a people with hearts of kingdom builders? This week we're going to be looking at that. Next week we're going to be taking that even further as we look at Nehemiah as an example of somebody that had the heart of a kingdom builder. And then in week 3 and 4 we're going to be taking it a little bit further, looking at practical things that we can do as a church and as believers to advance God's kingdom in our nation. We look forward to that. But before we start today, I think we just need to take some time to define what we mean when we speak about the kingdom of God. What is the kingdom of God? And when we look at the New Testament, we can summarize it in the following terms. The kingdom of God is a realm where Jesus Christ rules supreme and reigns supreme in the hearts of people. Not only that, it's the place where His blessings flow because of that rule and reign. And lastly, the subjects of this kingdom of God are you and I, the believers, the church. We are the subjects that are called to advance this kingdom. So it is the rule and reign of Christ in our hearts. It is the place where the blessing of God flows because of that rule and reign. And we are the subjects of the kingdom. Not only that, in the New Testament we see there is a present application and a future application when it comes to the kingdom of God. The New Testament shows us that when Jesus comes back, we will then experience the fullness of the kingdom of God, and we look forward to that day. But also it speaks about in the present tense that we are advancing the kingdom of God. We are already part of this kingdom. The Apostle Paul tells us we've been translated from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. So both you and I are citizens of this kingdom, and our king is Jesus. But also, Jesus says the kingdom has come, but interchangeably also speaks about the kingdom is coming, both a present and a future application. That is why we still use the Lord's Prayer, and we pray this: Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So even though we are awaiting the Lord's return for that final consummation of His kingdom, we are still praying today to see His kingdom come right here on earth as we, the citizens of this kingdom, advance this kingdom. Because both you and I want to see the rule and reign of Christ increase in our own hearts and in the hearts of even more people. We also want to see the blessings of God flow in our society, the kingdom of God coming in our communities. And how do we do this? You and I, Paul says in 2 Corinthians 5, he says the following: Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ. As subjects of this kingdom, we are called to be ambassadors of this kingdom as well. And an ambassador has full authority from the king to speak on his behalf and to act also on his behalf. How exciting is that? We are part of a kingdom. We have a king. We partake and enjoy the blessings of this kingdom. And we have been called to advance this kingdom throughout the world and in our nation as well. This is the kingdom that we are speaking about. And so this morning, I'm going to turn to one of our two main passages, Ephesians chapter 2, and it reads as follows. For by grace you've been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. In this famous passage, I believe it paints the picture of the kingdom so well. Firstly, there is a faith issue. The fact that we believe that we are redeemed and forgiven by the Lord, by grace through faith, it is not by our works. That's the starting point. But secondly, it speaks about works, that we've been created for good works by our Creator. So it's both of them. They walk together, both faith and works. But I want you to hear me. We start with faith. We rely wholeheartedly on God that He is going to fulfill His promises. But what we cannot do is defer our God-given responsibility back to God and expect Him to bail us out. That is not how the kingdom works. We cannot only pray and not apply kingdom principles. We cannot only pray for finances, but not actually think of the practical principles of hard work and wise financial stewardship. We cannot only pray for the lost, but not share the message of the gospel with them. We cannot only pray for spiritual growth, but not take the time to study God's word. We cannot only pray for the poor, but not be proactive in taking care of the poor. The heart of a kingdom builder firmly believes that God will fulfill his promises, but the kingdom builder also believes that he is called by God to do great works in advancing the kingdom. There's also the works issue that goes with it. This is something for us to ponder. If Junction Church and the people that are members of Junction Church had to magically disappear tomorrow, would people notice? Would they notice that kingdom builders have disappeared? That people that made a difference have disappeared? Would they yearn for our coming back because we made such an impact upon their lives? Or if that would happen, would they not notice at all? We need to make sure that we've got faith in God to fulfill His promises, but that we are called to advance His kingdom. And I'm going to take it a little bit further by looking at the Abrahamic covenant in Genesis. He says, "And I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. And I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed." In the New Testament, Paul says that we form part of this covenant because we are part of Abraham's seed. We are part of his descendants as the church. We are part of the spiritual blessing that we can be a blessing to our nation. Now, how can we be a blessing to our nation? Obviously, we've spoken about it, by advancing the kingdom of God, by being a kingdom builder. I'm going to try to summarize it as well as I can by saying the following. We advance this kingdom by the message we carry and the influence we have in society. The message we carry is the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and we believe that this message sets people free and offers them eternal life. The influence we have, however, is in the way that we work, in the way that we raise our families, in the way that we impact our communities, and our character. All of these things advance God's kingdom and it blesses our nation. Now, I want all of us to take a moment to answer three very important questions. The first question is, are you sold out to live for God and His kingdom? The heart of a kingdom builder is absolutely sold out for God. They want to see God rule and reign in their hearts, that His will is done in their lives, and that His will touches those that they are trying to influence. There is no distraction. There is no duplicity. There is no desire to live for your own desires unless they line up with the will of God. And I want to remind us of that famous passage from John Wesley that we shared last week. Give me 100 men who fear nothing but sin and desire nothing but God, and I care not whether they be clergymen or laymen, they alone will shake the gates of hell and set up the kingdom of heaven upon the earth. So I ask again, are you sold out for the kingdom of God? Then we come to our second question. Are you convicted that the gospel is the only message to salvation and sets people free? The Apostle Paul proclaims the following in Romans chapter 1. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. It can be hard to be the odd one out in society if you stand up for truth and you stand up for righteousness. But remember, we have got a mandate to share this good news. But the question is, are you convicted and convinced by this message of the gospel and being able to go and share it with people? And that brings us to our last question. Are you living a life of godly purpose in all things? We need to get away from the sacred and secular divide that we've set up in our society. That on Sunday you go to church and that is sacred, and on Monday you go to work and that is secular. Because that is not how the kingdom of God actually operates. Because the kingdom of God must advance in all things and in every area of life. And so if you're a business person, for argument's sake, is the kingdom of God front and center of your mind? That your product can be used to bless your customers? That you can employ more people to see more people raised out of poverty? That your industry can expand the economy of this nation, that more people can step into prosperity? And that your business networks can be used to influence people and also share the gospel with those that you come into contact with? For those of you that are teachers and childminders, that you are taking the time to educate the next generation and set godly values in place for society. For parents, that you are raising your children in godliness, that they can be missional from a young age already. And for those of you with great marriages, that you are taking the time to influence the couples that you come into contact with. And for those of you, even in your hobbies and the stuff that you do in your off time, even those can be opportunities to raise networks and to start to share the gospel with people. Do you wake up with a sense of godly purpose in the morning to advance God's kingdom? These are deep and profound questions this morning, but we have to take them seriously. If we are to arise and build in this nation and in our communities, we need to have the heart of a kingdom builder. The kingdom of God is where Jesus reigns in our hearts, His blessings flow, and we as subjects of the kingdom are His ambassadors to advance that kingdom. How do we do it? By faith and by action. By the message that we carry and the influence that we have in our society. And by doing that, we become a blessing to our nation if we are sold out for the kingdom of God. We are convicted by the message that we carry, and every day we wake up with a deep sense of purpose of advancing the kingdom of God in everything that we do, in every sphere of society. Let's arise and build. God bless you.
You're the God of this city. You're the King of these people. You're the Lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. For greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. Greater things have yet to come, and greater things are still to be done in this city. You're the God of this city. You're the King of these people. You're the Lord of this nation. You are. You're the light in this darkness. You're the hope to the hopeless. You're the peace to the restless. You are. There is no one like I.
Greater things have yet to come, and greater.